that if we are to write down everything that Jesus accomplished during his short stay on earth, it will take all the papers of this world to write them down. But today, we shall attempt to examine few that we can easily recall. The only Bible in the Old Testament or in the New Testament, although affirm that the foundational rock upon which Christianity stands is based on faith and belief. Yet it does not condemn us to treat these two conditions alone without giving us enough evidence and proof sufficient to reinforce our faith, which we shall be unfolding today. 1. John, one of Jesus' disciples, testified Jesus as coming from God, as we read in John 3:34. For he whom God hath sent speaketh the words of God. For God giveth not the Spirit by measure unto him. And in John 5:24, it says, Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word, and believeth on him that sent me, hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. And in John 6:38, he said, For I came down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. Second consideration, that Jesus is the one who qualified as a teacher come from God to change humanity from their sinful nature to righteousness. And this is also justified in John 3:2. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Even the eminent class of rabbis and Pharisees, like Nicodemus, came to Jesus at night and acknowledged him as a great teacher come from God. 3. Our Lord Jesus was also a super administrator, unparalleled in human history. How many big organizations have collapsed? Even though a few years back, they were the most talked about in all stock exchange international markets, such as the Wall Street, but today have been sold out or begging to be bailed out, despite the fact that they were managed by many of the world's best business executives, while many have declared bankruptcy to save their skin. Our Lord Jesus Christ took roughly 3.5 years to establish God's ministry on earth, which had withstood all sorts of storms, from the Jewish leaders to the Roman Mighty Empires and the Constantinople Crusade, and currently religious persecutions from other religions such as Islam, Buddhism, and socialist countries of China, Cuba, and Pakistan. While Christ today is under both spiritual and psychological, physical, as well as mental attacks through eminent religious leaders, world powers, and the rich of this world in the name of one world order. Under the guise of one world order, all the moral teachings of Jesus Christ have been compromised or deleted or altered in their new versions of their Bible, in circulation made available to us to corrupt our minds and replace that double-edged sword, which is the word that God has given to us by Christ, with butter knife to render us defenseless to withstand the works of the devil when faced with trials of this world. Many are falling, and many are still falling, when confronted with a little crisis of misunderstanding, and hence is stopped from running from churches to churches like prostitutes. The Christians who hold fast to their cross, as Jesus meant it, instead of dying, they are growing more bold, resolute, and ready to die for their faith in Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus appointed 12 educated illiterates to a very low background, with the purpose of training them to manage the universal church he built on the rock, through which all those who believe will be taught and show the way to salvation and eternal life. Why Jesus did choose 12 disciples in particular? The answer is in the Old Testament. God chose to raise his chosen people from the 12 tribes of Israel. And hence Jesus was at creation. He followed God's plan with Joshua after God made them cross River Jordan on dry ground, as the children of Israel, each according to their tribe, carry a stone to make a landmark inside the river before the walls of water collapsing. When you write down letter 12 in figures, you write 1 and you write 2. And when you now add 1 and 2 together, you get 3, which is a symbol of Trinity: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. And Jesus being the Son, he is the Word, by which the Father created heaven and earth, as we also read in John chapter 1, verse 1 to 3. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shined in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Amen.
Amen.
Despite all available evidences, even in the Old Testament, the religious leaders were blinded to the truth that they were reading in their Bible called Torah, which are the first 5 Gospels in the Bible, from Genesis to Deuteronomy. And yet, we are denied the revelation which are being revealed to you and me today. We should be grateful to God. Because in Genesis 1:1-26, it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And verse 26, and God said, let us make man in our own image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creating thing that creepeth upon the earth.
Amen.
God could have used your pronoun, let me make. But instead, he acknowledged and affirmed the presence of Jesus at the creation by using the plural pronoun, us, our, because God was not referring to the angels as in our own image. When Jesus was challenged by the Jewish religious leaders, when he told them that Abraham saw his days and was happy, and they wondered, how could a young man from Nazareth, whose father was a carpenter, claim to know our father Abraham? Let us see what John says in chapter 8, verse 32. Then said the Jews unto him, now we know that thou hast a devil. Abraham is dead, and the prophets too are dead. And thou seest, if a man keep my saying, he shall never taste of death. Are thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead, and the prophets are dead? Who makest thou thyself? Jesus answered, if I honor myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honored me, of whom ye say that he is your God. Yet ye have not known him, but I know him. And if I should say, I know him not, I shall be a liar, like unto you. But I know him and keep his saying. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Then said the Jews unto him, thou art not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham? Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Even King David, through whom generation the Messiah came, recognized his divinity. And we also read in Psalm 8, 1 and 2, and he reads, O Lord our God, how excellent is thy name in all the earth, who has set thy glory above the heavens, out of the mouth of babes and sucklings, and thou ordained strength because of thy enemies, that thou might steal the enemy and the avenger. King David was a great man after God's own heart. He got the revelation of the Messiah coming through his knowledge and called him Lord, coming to put the avenger Satan into chains and recover from him the heritage he stole from the first man Adam. The fourth consideration, Jesus leadership training. Jesus leadership training. After training the 12 disciples for a while, Jesus sent them out with specific instruction, as we read also in Luke 9, 1-5. Then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. And he said unto them, take nothing for your journey, neither stamps, nor scrip, nor bread, neither money, neither have two coats of peace. And whatsoever house ye enter into, there abide, and thence depart. And whosoever will not receive you, when you go out of that city, shake off the very dust from your feet for a testimony against them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And they departed. I went through the towns preaching the gospel and healing everywhere. He sent them out so that they could get experience and the picture of what their future assignment will be, and to be able to ask and learn from him while he is still within them in the physical. This is part of the cross Jesus was referring to. A life of service to humanity, where you have to dissociate yourself from your families, from your friends, from your loved ones, and above, give your time and talents to the service and glory of Christ, only without expectation of carnal reward. This is why he said in Luke 9:62, no one, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. Look at the words, putting the hand to the plow. These words tell us why we become a disciple of Jesus. Some people seem to have the understanding that becoming a Christian is simply a matter of having a certain religion that you embrace and that you use to comfort your heart. They like Christianity because it gives them a kind of moral and emotional support. Well, the Word of God certainly gives us some support, and it can certainly comfort our heart. But that is not the essence of Christianity. Being called to be a Christian is to be called to put your hand to the plow. And what does it mean to plow? To plow is to walk the land. So to put hand to the plow is to serve God. Now we are not talking about being a pastor or a missionary or any kind of full-time ministry. The Lord Jesus Christ is simply saying that no matter what kind of Christian you are, No matter how young you are in Christ or how old you are in Christ, every Christian should be active in God's service. He does not stay idle. Being a member of a church does not make you a Christian. A person shows that he is a Christian when he puts his hand to God's plow. He is acting for God. He lives daily for God. A person who makes the decision to follow Christ has committed his life to God's service by plowing his field. The fifth consideration. Who was Jesus in human flesh? And how has he distinguished himself above all human beings to be divine? I often ask myself, can I ever be like Jesus and be ready to drink the same cup like him? To be able to answer this mind-boggling question, we have to go back and examine